In this video, we're going to go over the base data that came with your ACPF file geodatabase. This data has been custom developed by the ACPF team at the HUC-12 scale. Alright, so before we begin, we have to go get our file geodatabase with our watershed. So we're back at the North Central Region Water Network website where the ACPF data is hosted. We'll scroll down, go into our land use viewer. And I covered this in detail on how to navigate it in the first setup video. So if you'd like to see more, go view that video again. But for this, I'm just going to zoom through. So I go to search, and the watershed that I will be using for a large majority of these videos is called Mosquito Creek in Iowa. The HUC-12 ID is 07080205053. So I double click that, I select my watershed, make sure that you're on download file geodatabase, and enter some quick information about yourself. This helps us keep track of who is downloading it, and it'll add you to a mailing list. We don't email out often either, it's just for updates. And then this little window pops up once I hit download that tells me how many I'm downloading and then which coordinate system it'll be projected in this case, UTM zone 15. You can download a maximum of 10 at a time. So we hit okay and the download will begin. So there it appears, I can just hit save. And then if I navigate to Windows Explorer and goes to my downloads folder, I can see that it is sitting there. If you didn't have 7-zip, you could right click and there would be an extract files option, but I do have 7-zip. So I'll come here, hit extract files. And then I want to place it on my C drive, on my hard drive. So I'll navigate to this PC, go down to my C drive. I have a folder named ACPF data where I store my watersheds. So I'll select that, hit OK. I'll keep the original name. It's a good habit to always end in your HUC-12 ID so you remember what it is. And then you hit OK. And if we go to that C drive location, ACPF data, you can see our file geodatabase is sitting right here inside this folder. And we'll explore this later in our catalog and actually see all the file formats. All right, so we've downloaded our data and now it's time to set up a folder connection. So we'll do connect to folder. This PC, I'm on my local C drive, ACPF data, and I'll hit okay. So now if I open up this folder, I can see the folder that contains my file geodatabase. And there it is. And here's all the base data that you get when you download the ACPF file geodatabase. So in this file geodatabase, we have our base data. And this is also the location where all outputs from the ACPF tools are going to be directed to. Every single data piece has a base name. And then a majority of the data is also followed by the 12-digit HUC ID. All output names will also end in this 12-digit HUC ID. When you're running the tools, you may optionally change the base name if something makes more sense to you, or say you're rerunning a process a few times over. However, make sure that everything always ends in these 12-digit HUC IDs. Some of the tools will automatically grab data and bring them in for inputs, and it's going to be looking for this ending. So it's very important that you keep that same file name structure. All right, so briefly, I'm just going to go over what is in our file geodatabase. First, we have the watershed boundary feature class denoted by BND. We then have a buffered watershed boundary that encompasses the field boundaries denoted by BUF. We have our crop history table. We have a field boundary feature class. We have the G-Surgo raster, which contains soil information. We have a land use table denoted by LU6. This contains general land use classifications for the past 6 years. We have three soil tables, the soil profile table, surface horizon table, and then the surface texture table. You then have a suite of crop data layer rasters
Mine range from 2008 to 2016.
All right, so to begin, let's look at some of our boundary information. First off, we have our watershed boundary denoted by BND, followed by that HUC-12 digit code. And this has been derived from the National Hydrologic Dataset. The next piece of boundary information is our buffered watershed boundary. That is the watershed boundary buffered out 1,000 meters. And this makes sure that it encompasses all fields that lie partly within the watershed. And it's also used to clip all of the rosters to this extent. And lastly, we have our actual field boundary data set here. This was developed from the pre-2008 Farm Bill CLUs, and all identifiable information has been removed from them. And they were originally digitized to the 2009 NAS land use, however, that's being updated currently. So if we take a look at the attribute table, you can see we have a field boundary ID, so this is a unique identifier here. This will be used to join a lot of the outputs or tables to this feature class. We have the acreage of the field.
We then have an isAg field, which contains values of 0, 1, or 2. 0 indicates non-agricultural. 1 indicates that it is cropland. And a value of 2 means that it is pasture. You will have the opportunity to manually update these field boundaries within the utilities of the ACPF toolbox.
All right, now we'll make our way through the land use data that the ACPF geodatabase provides. First off, let's take a look at a couple of these NAS crop data layer rosters. Each of these are developed by the USDA for each available year here. The ACPF downloads at least the past 6 years. You can see here we have a couple more than the past 6 years. And what we do is overlay the field boundary with all of these years available and then extract information by field. The NAS dataset contains over 100 values, so this gets condensed down using an ACPF lookup table. And if you remember, that lookup table was downloaded when we got the ACPF toolbox. It's right there. The next piece of land use data will be the crop history table. You can see we have our field boundary ID here. And then all the other information within this table is about the major land use in each field for each year, and then the percent of major land use that makes up. So these are all codes, and then this provides the percent that actually makes up. And you can see we have the major land use for 2008, percent that makes up for 2008, and that goes all the way to 2015 in this case. Our final piece of land use data is the land use 6 table. This again contains the field boundary ID. And then we have a crop rotation and a general land use field as well. This looks up the last 6 years of land use in each field. And then to get this general land use classification, we use a rule-based classification. If you go into your metadata folder and then go down to the land use 6 table and scroll down, you can see in this field we explain that classification system and how we come up with these general land use classes using the crop rotation field. Also, a little bit further down, we define what each of those crop rotation values signifies. All right, so now let's take a look at some of the soil data that you get with your download. First off, we have a G-Surgo roster. And this is a 10-meter roster. It has an attribute table as well. If we take a look at that, you can see there are quite a few fields that can give you information about the soil within each map unit. And you can see it's broken down by this MU key, map unit key. And this is a very valuable field, especially when later on you'll be joining soil tables to the G-Surgo roster. The next soil data set that we have is the soil profile table. And you can see that MU key field right here. So you could join the soil profile table to the GSurgo roster using this as the join field. And the soil profile table provides information at depth of each map unit. So we can get information such as available water storage and percent organic matter or coarse soils within each map unit within the soil profile table. The next table is the surface horizon table. This provides information about the surface horizon. And here again, we have the MU key. So we could join the surface horizon to the GSurgo. And then we also have a co-key, the component key. And this is a valuable field if you are going to be joining the surface texture table, which is the next piece of soil information that we get. So the surface texture table tells you about the texture class and parent material. And you can see here, all we have is the co-key. There is no MU key. So if you would like to join the surface texture to the GSurgo, first you're going to join the surface texture to the surface horizon based on the co-key. Then using the MU key from the surface horizon table, you'll join it to the GSurgo. All right, so that's your soil data. So we just went over all of the base data that comes with your ACPF geodatabase, but you may have noticed we don't have a DEM. So that means you have to go out and get your own. On this slide here, I've provided some sources that may have an adequate DEM for you, but there are many more out there to explore. Some key things to note is that the ACPF requires your DEM to be in whole meters. You also need to be aware of your Z units, and this will not be contained in the layer properties, only in the metadata. The ACPF can handle any vertical units as long as a Z factor is provided. The Z factor is a conversion factor where it is the number of horizontal or XY units within the Z unit. So for example, if you had a meters horizontal unit, but then a centimeter Z unit, your Z factor is going to be 0.01. That is the number of meters that fits into a centimeter. The ACPF does tend to work better if the Z units are in centimeters. It just reduces storage requirements and any issues with quantization. Another important thing to note is that the same coordinate system must be used for your DEM as it is for the rest of the layers. The ACPF data is provided in UTM, so make sure that your DEM is also in that coordinate system. Lastly, the DEM should be the same extent as the buffered watershed boundary. So you could use the clip or mask. I recommend the clip tool to make it that same extent. All right, so let's take a look real quick at the DEM I got. So I found a DEM, and you can see I've already clipped it to that buffered watershed boundary. And right now it's a TIFF, and it's sitting outside of my file geodatabase. I need it inside. When you run any ACPF tool, the inputs should be coming from your ACPF file geodatabase. So to get it inside, I'm going to right click my ACPF file geodatabase and go down to import raster dataset. And then I'll grab this raster and drag and drop it in. We can see it's going to the right place. So we'll hit okay and let it go. While that's running, we can open up the properties of this one and take a quick look. Right now it's still in TIFF format, but we can see that I have a 2 meter, this is the horizontal unit raster. If we scroll down to the spatial reference section, I see that I already have it projected in the appropriate spatial reference. For me, that's UTM zone 15. If this was not the correct spatial reference for you, you could reproject. And I would recommend first importing it into the file geodatabase and then reprojecting from there. And then the last important piece of information is the linear unit, which is in meters. You always want this to be in meters to have efficiently running ACPF tools. So hit OK, and let's take a look at the file geodatabase, and there it is sitting there, and everything looks good to me. If we open up the properties, we can see that basically everything's the same, except for now my data type is a file geodatabase roster dataset, which is good. Here's a brief recap of everything we just went over with your ACPF geodatabase and DEM download. Now it's time to move on to running some of the ACPF tools.